The world has heaved a sigh of relief that finally a 60-day-long ceasefire has been negotiated between Israel and Hezbollah. The simple fact is that the Hezbollah had taken very heavy casualties and attrition, especially of its top leadership, which has been wiped out many times over. It's also suffered material damage because the Israeli Air Force went on an all-out offensive against the command and control setup of the Hezbollah, against its rocket and missile bases and its arsenals and weapon storage, rocket storage sites. It has gone on an all-out offensive, you know, using intelligence means like exploding pagers and walkie-talkies. It's caused serious attrition and damage to Hezbollah. It has degraded the fighting capabilities of the Hezbollah to a dangerous degree, and therefore the Hezbollah has been forced to accept a ceasefire. For their part, the Hezbollah are maintaining the attitude of defiance, and they say that they have prevented the Israeli ground forces from seizing even the first line of border towns and villages, and they are strongly ensconced, and they had caused heavy casualties to the Israeli forces, and that they had continued the fire of rockets and missiles into Israel. But the fact of the matter is that Israel, the Hezbollah, was the main target of Israel right throughout. Over the past decade, they knew that the greatest threat that comes to them in the Middle East is from the Hezbollah, which is the proxy, the prime proxy of Iran. So they had, you know, collected a lot of intelligence against this organization, and when the time came, they struck hard, and they struck in a manner that was devastating. Rarely have we seen a terrorist organization mauled so badly in such a short time as the Israelis did to the Hezbollah. They were not prepared to deal with the Hamas, and that showed in that extended 1.5 year long campaign almost, in which they still have not been able to totally pulverize the Hamas. But the Hezbollah, like I said, was another cup of tea. The Israeli army was very well prepared to act against it. They had been making up their contingency plan. They had thoroughly penetrated this organization from the human point of view, technical intelligence point of view. And when the time came, they struck ruthlessly and they struck hard. And it was a very short campaign, actually, compared to what's happened in Gaza, where they were caught by surprise, where they did not have adequate intelligence, and the Hamas hit them and went underground into the tunnels. So where their artificial intelligence, facial recognition softwares did not work. But that was not the case in Beirut, that was not the case in Lebanon, and therefore we today have a ceasefire. So why did Israel settle for a ceasefire? Netanyahu very clearly said that he wants to give time for rest and refit to his forces. They have been fighting non-stop for quite some time, so he wanted to give them a break. There is, also a speculation that maybe this ceasefire will not hold. From what we have seen on the very first day, there seem to have been accusations of violations and threats to escalate again. So I'm not very sure how long this ceasefire will hold. That's number one. Given the highly antagonistic stances on both sides, and there has been a kind of a celebratory fireworks in Lebanon. That the Hezbollah has, you know, claiming a victory of sorts. So I don't think the Israelis would like that very much, and they'd like to then, there could be a total breakdown of this ceasefire. There's another angle to it, which is very, very interesting. During this latest round of fighting, it was found that lots of rockets and missiles, some even possibly hypersonic missiles, were getting through to the Hezbollah and they were being routed from Iran via Syria and Iraq. So now we find that though there is a ceasefire against the Hezbollah technically, they have launched a major offensive using their Islamic Sunni proxies against Bashar al-Assad and major attacks in Aleppo, one of the main primary cities of Syria. They are trying to target the Bashar al-Assad regime. Possibly they want to depose that regime, have a regime change, and try and ensure that no weapon supplies can go through Syria. And possibly the same thing may then be replicated in Iraq. Now, the problem is that in Syria, we have the Russian troop contingents. In fact, it is the Russians who saved Bashar al-Assad from an overthrow. And whether they will tamely now accept an overthrow of Bashar al-Assad, because it is linked with their bases on the Mediterranean. It gives them a foothold in the Middle East region, which is very important for the Russians. So I don't think they are going to throw in the towel that easily and let Bashar al-Assad regime go down or collapse in any way possible. They will resist it, they will fight it, and there are even speculation that it is the Russians that are providing the weapons via Syria to the Hezbollah, especially the recent drones, the recent weapons, which were not jammable, interceptable. I mean, they defeated the Iron Dome. They were hitting, and you could see the impact of those explosions in Israeli towns and cities. So there is a complex game which is now on. Though there is a ceasefire in with the Hezbollah, there seems to be an intensification of the conflict in Syria, in a bid to dethrone the Bashar al-Assad regime and put in place proxies who will prevent the infiltration of Syrian missiles and rockets and drones to the Hezbollah. It is their primary route is via Syria. So that is one aspect. The other aspect is the very curious aspect of why at this stage there are protests in Israel that look, Joe Biden has lost the election, he is a lame duck president, we don't owe him any favors, and this ceasefire goes entirely to Joe Biden's credit that he has been able to enforce peace in this place. And they were saying if you had just waited till 20th of January when Donald Trump would have taken charge. Donald Trump is highly pro-Israel, highly anti-Iran, and the Israelis were hopeful that they would get a much better deal. But we are not sure how that will pan out even now, because there have been three telephonic conversations and more between Donald Trump and Netanyahu, because they are very close. Donald Trump is extremely supportive of Israel and very much hostile to Iran. So what would Donald Trump do? The only fact is that Donald Trump is now made a commitment to the American people that both these unnecessary wars he will tamp down, number one. Number two, he wants to take on the deep state. He wants to cleanse America of its illegal immigrants, 11 million of them. He wants them to be identified, rounded up and thrown out of America back to the countries they came from, right? So he is going to go on that big drive, and for that he needs peace outside. He can't be fighting wars within with his own deep state and at the same time engaging in major wars in Europe and in the Middle East. So he is keen, and I think this may possibly have been discussed, the timings of these between Israel and the United States, because even Israel, you find an element of fatigue setting in into the mobilized troops. How long can you sustain this peak mobilization? It will affect the Israeli economy. So possibly there is scope, there is this thing for a kind of a ceasefire in which at the very least the combatants will try and regain their strength, regain their breath and come back to this process few months, possibly a year down the line, when Donald Trump is more ready to, you know, fight wars abroad, that he may possibly have settled the war within the United States, where he has to deal with the deep state. And that's a very major challenge. The deep state is not going to bow out in a hurry. In fact, Putin has been warning Donald Trump to be careful, that the deep state is capable of doing anything. Starting a nuclear war in Ukraine, starting a third world war in Ukraine, intensifying the conflict, creating a nuclear disaster, and just to muddy the waters for Donald Trump. Donald Trump wants peace, but like Putin has cautioned him, that he has to be careful. The deep state is quite capable of trying to eliminate. After all, the deep state had assassinated Kennedy, John F. Kennedy, very popular leader who was trying to take on the deep state at that time, and he was eliminated. He was assassinated in a clear kind of a counter coup, as it is, by the deep state. So there have already been two, possibly more, assassination attempts against Donald Trump, and he'll have to be extremely vigilant and careful, and his new team must come in. In fact, Lieutenant General Flynn has openly accused Joe Biden of trying to subvert the election, subvert the verdict of the electorate, and trying to create a messy situation for Donald Trump so that he's hampered from his peace efforts, from his efforts to bring peace in Europe, peace in the Middle East. He is stymied. He is forced into a situation where he will have no option but to continue with the war that Donald Trump has, that Joe Biden has started. Joe Biden just doesn't want these wars to end. He's prepared to push it to the nuclear level in Ukraine. And there you see a dichotomy in the approaches to the Middle East and a dichotomy in the approach to the Russia-Ukraine war. In the Middle East, he's been harping on a ceasefire for months and months. And it is Netanyahu who ignored his calls for a ceasefire, and he went hammer and tongs for the Hezbollah, because 60,000 of his people have been displaced from northern Israel. He had to get them back. He can't afford a situation where there are rocket barrages, missile barrages from Lebanon into Israel, and 60 to 70,000 people are thrown out of their homes in northern Israel. He has to resettle them back. So therefore, he refused to listen to Biden's advice as far as the Hezbollah was concerned, and he went all out and decimated the Hezbollah. He has significantly degraded the capabilities of the Hezbollah, right, and also of the Hamas. They may be taking the odd pot shot here and then, but by and large, the Hezbollah as a fighting force has taken serious losses, and it will take time to recover from these losses. No wonder it has accepted the ceasefire. It is badly wounded, especially in terms of its command and control attrition, which has been prohibitive. Prohibitive is the word. Now comes the fact that Donald Trump was keen on a more aggressive approach in the Middle East, because he's antipathetic to Iran. He finds Iran a great looming threat, especially with its nuclear weapons capability, nascent capability, which could any day turn real. So he was keen to escalate possibly here and not escalate in the Russia-Ukraine war. And you see Donald Trump's opponents, the Democrats, playing just the opposite playbook. And they are trying to escalate in Europe and get down the conflict in Middle East, and so that Biden can claim credit. You see, whichever way it is, I am quite convinced that Donald Trump will want to fulfill his promises to the American electorate. He will not want a major war, two major wars, to cloud the opening phase of his presidency. He wants to focus on the economy. He wants to mend the American economy, because of which the Democrats have lost. The middle class was finding the prices going up through the roof. They weren't enough to put food on the table. The prices of housing was going through the roof. Donald Trump has to mend all that. He has to deal with the deep state. He has to deal with the illegal immigrants. So I think he will need a period of external stability, peace and quiet so that he can focus within. But what Joe Biden is doing is, he's threatening to give nuclear weapons to Ukraine. He's already used his Oshnik hypersonic intercontinental ballistic missile in Dnipro to destroy, to pulverize that factory for, which used to be making intercontinental ballistic missiles in the Soviet era. And now it is being converted to make tactical ballistic missiles of the 200-300 kilometer range and more by the Ukrainian. It has been pulverized, it has been destroyed. A clear message has been sent to Europe and to the United States that, look, we have weapon systems that you just cannot stop. And with it, we can take out all your airfields in Europe. We can severely hit the command and control platforms. And Putin has said that you continue with this usage of ATACMs and Storm Shadows and you will get it right back. And the next major target, he said that on the 30th, we might be striking Kyiv. And pamphlets have been dropped in Kyiv for the local citizens to get out. He says, we don't want to cause collateral damage to the civil population. So the local people can have been told to get the hell out of Kyiv. And even the Americans were evacuating their embassies, and so were some other European countries, NATO countries, evacuating their embassies, hiding their staff in anticipation of a major strike by the Russians with the with these hypersonic intermediate range Olchnik missiles, which can be devastating, which are just one shot of the use of nuclear weapons without the contamination, radioactive, etc., and the other poisonous aspects of nuclear warfare. But the impact of this arsenic has been devastating in Dnipro. It has pulverized that factory. You know, there are, it's hypersonic, it comes at Mach 11, 12, 13. And with that velocity itself, the kinetic energy is so high of the impact that it can go penetrate deep underground, destroy facilities deep underground also. So, if these are used against the air bases of the UK, France, American air bases in Europe, and one of the likely targets could be the American anti-ballistic missile base in Poland, which the Russians are concerned about. So, they could knock that out. But very definitely, they are going to knock targets in Ukraine first. They have almost 50% of the energy capacity infrastructure of Ukraine has been knocked out. And the Ukrainians are going to face a miserable winter for the satisfaction and the media posturing of Zelensky, that I am hitting at the Russians. Well, the impact of your strikes and the strikes of the Russians is not at all commensurate. The Russians have pulverized 50% of the energy infrastructure of Ukraine, and at this rate they might even hit it harder. They are going to now go in for command and control targets, key targets, with a weapon system that the United States, NATO countries, Israel, none of them is capable of intercepting. And President Putin has gone on record. He is coming almost daily on Russian television to tell them of this, that this is, you can't intercept this system. You can't stop me. If I use these Olchnik hypersonic IRBMs, you will be finished. You will have no answer. You will be pulverized. And the danger is now that if he hits Ukraine, fine. But if he now decides to do horizontal escalation and widen the ambit of the conflict to other NATO countries, and then Article 5 kicks in, and then we have a proper full-scale third world war with the highest potential of crossing the nuclear threshold. Because if the if the NATO are going to mass 100,000 troops against Russia in the East European republics, East European nations, well, you have a major escalation coming, and that would leave Russia with no options but to retaliate in a nuclear manner. Battlefield nuclear weapons would be used first, and then subsequently higher yield nuclear weapons on the air bases, command and control centers in UK, in France, in Europe, in even Alaska. And if things push comes to shove, well, once it goes to the level of Washington, you have a full-scale nuclear war on your hands. Is that wise, sagacious policy? Does that show any concern for the millions and millions of American citizens who would be the target of these nuclear war fighting? The citizens of Europe? There seems to be a total absence of concern for the populations and for the population that they are suffering. The Americans have demanded that Ukraine mobilize 1 million men. So they are pulling out, 8 million men have gone, 1 million have been killed. So they are pulling out teenagers, they are pulling out people from old people's homes, old veterans like me, to sort of push them back into action. It is slave trade of a new kind. You know, trying to fight Russia to the last Ukrainian, it is morally abominable, despicable strategy to fight Russia to the last Ukrainian. And it is extremely sad that Ukraine, that claims to be fighting on behalf of democracy and liberal values, well, his tenure is over. And he legally is not entitled to carry on the government. He should have been holding elections, which he says he can't hold because of the emergency. And so he can continue on forever and ever in power. And it is an extremely corrupt government which leaks like a sieve. All the aid being given to it, about half of it is purloined and lines the pockets of the Ukrainian elite. So it now remains to be seen whether Joe Biden will succeed in his attempt to rock the boat for Donald Trump, to create problems for him so that he cannot deliver on his election promises. He wants the wars that he has continued to be his legacy, to continue on and on forever and ever, at least the war in Europe. That was his pet project. The war in the Middle East caught him by surprise. I mean, left to himself, he would have liked to focus on Europe. But this was a major digression for him. And he was very keen to have it over and done with, dusted. But it is Israel that defied his this thing, and has only now, for some reason, been prevailed upon to go in for this ceasefire. I think the reason possibly is exhaustion on the side also of the Israelis. They've been fighting non-stop for over a year. They're not a nation that can afford long periods of mobilization. So I think it suits everybody to have a break in the Middle East. We hope it lasts. It is a very tenuous ceasefire as of now. There are lots of threats being given by both sides, and this ceasefire may not hold. The chances of it breaking down are very high, are extremely high. And the kind of, under the cover of this ceasefire, the intensification of operations in Syria is also a little disturbing as to what exactly are the real motives behind this ceasefire. There seems to be something more to it than meets the eye. And if Joe Biden, before he heads into the sunset, hands over nuclear weapons to Kyiv, we have a disaster on our hands, a disaster on a planetary scale on our hands, because Russia has made it plain that we will use every weapon system at our command to hit back then. If you try and, this is against the laws of proliferation, the treaties of proliferation, if America does this, well, it is the ultimate danger it is posing to the to the Russians. And just like America had, you know, made a big song and dance about nuclear weapons being positioned in Cuba, now giving it to the Ukraine is an existential threat. And to imagine that Russia will take it tamely, every single red line will be crossed and at the end of it, Putin will do nothing, I think is a serious, serious misperception, which could prove to be extremely costly. Thank you.